We're standing on the greatest archaeological site in Israel, Tel Hasor. It was the only city built on a hill that was destroyed by fire by Joshua and his soldiers. And then many centuries later, Tiglath-Pileser, also called Pul in the Bible, came here and he destroyed the city. How do we know it? If you look down here, you'll see a black line running just above these stones. This was done by Tiglath-Pileser. The Bible mentions it, and here we see the layer of burnt ash. The archaeologist tells us that when they opened this, they could smell the ashes. The Bible is a reliable book. You read it, and then you come to archaeology, and you see the evidence of the truthfulness of the Bible. Many kings lived here. They're gone. But God's word is eternal. It's beautiful, it's refreshing. When you read it, when you get exposure to the Bible, it changes your life, your outlook on life, and God becomes more precious to you. This is a great experience to see with your eyes that Scripture is authentic. King Solomon, he was a great man. He started out obeying God, and then women destroyed the man's life. And right at the end of his life, he wrote Ecclesiastes, and he warned the young people to follow God. But he became a very cruel tyrant, and he made some enemies. One of them was Jeroboam. Jeroboam fled to Egypt, and when Solomon died, Jeroboam came back. In the meantime, Rehoboam, the king of Solomon, ruled in Jerusalem. And then the 10 tribes from the north came to Rehoboam and said, "Please, can you lower the taxes?" And he said, "I'll speak to my counselors." So the old people said, "Lower the taxes." The young people said, "Push it up." Of course, he listened to the young people, and the kingdom split. Jeroboam took the 10 tribes, and in order to keep them here and not let them go to Jerusalem to worship in the temple, right here he erected 2 golden calves. Now, he learned this cultic way of worship in Egypt. At the Serapeum at Saqqara, near Memphis, they worshipped the bulls. When you read ancient history, people of all nations worshipped the bull. The Assyrians worshipped the bull. It was a very popular. The bull is strong, and people like to worship something strong. So here he erected 2 golden calves, bull calves. And the people came here and worshipped. It is a very sad story. Don't worship the bulls of Tel Dan. Go to Jerusalem and worship God, a God you cannot see, because he's too great to be reduced to something tangible or audible. He's a God that transcends time and space and the cosmos. May God help us never to worship golden calves, whatever form they may take, but worship only God at Jerusalem, the city of God, where the high priest Jesus Christ is officiating. Only in the light of archaeology can you understand certain passages in Scripture. In Matthew 16, we read about Christ saying to his disciples, "If anyone wants to follow me, let him take up his cross, deny himself daily and follow me." Now, he came to this heathen place called Philippi Caesarea. Now, when you get here, you get the picture. Here was a temple for Pan, Panikos, the Greek god. And this was essential worship. So Christ and his disciples sat somewhere here while the prostitutes were coming to the temple. And I think Peter went like this. They've just come, according to the previous chapters of the book of Matthew, from the hatred and the prejudice of the Pharisees. Now we've got two kinds of sins. The sins of disposition. They were building up emotions against the Sanhedrin and the enemies. One temptation. Here they come, and there's another temptation. The temptation of the flesh. And Jesus says to them, if you want to follow me, there's only one rule. You've got to deny yourself, your disposition, attitude towards the enemies, and your attitude towards the prostitutes. This was essential worship. All the worship, ancient worship, was sensual worship. It's not what you heard, but what you felt. And it was expected from every woman, at least once in a lifetime, to come and do temple prostitution. So, I don't know if they had extra volunteers, but there were many women here. And Jesus was sitting with his disciples and telling them, my dear followers, if you want to follow me, deny yourself. Say no, no, no to temptation. Say no to sensual temptation. Say no to dispositional temptations. Hating somebody, building negative feelings towards somebody. So if you have a problem of not forgiving somebody, remember what Christ said right here. Deny yourself. Take up your cross daily and follow me. And if you've got a sensual problem, physical problem, there's only one solution. Deny yourself. Self-sacrifice, self-denial is better than self-gratification. This is the message of Banias, Panikos, Caesarea Philippi. And I'm so glad to be here to repeat the story of Christ at the site where he spoke to his poor disciples, teaching them these great lessons. There's one word in Greek, Makarios. Makarios means the happiness of the gods. And one spring morning, Jesus sat here and he spoke about happiness. Blessed is the man. Blessed is the man. Blessed is the peacemaker. Blessed is the pure in heart. All the blessednesses, the makariosis, the greatest joy lies in chapter 5 of Matthew. What he spoke at Sinai, he again repeated right here. It was a spring morning, birds were flying in the sky, flowers were all over the place. There was an expectancy with the crowd, and suddenly he opens his mouth and he gave them the Beatitudes. Now in the book of the Desire of Ages, it says it was like an amphitheater. And here you see the natural amphitheater. So please read Matthew 5-7. It's a beautiful story of real happiness. It's unselfish service for others and for God. This is tapha. According to tradition, Jesus was first preaching up there, and then he came down, gave another sermon, and the people listened to him all day long. Towards evening, he said to the disciples, listen, we must feed the people. And they made all excuses. You know, when God wants us to feed people, do something for him, we've got excuses. We haven't got food. So Andrew got a little boy with 5 loaves of bread, and 2 little sardines. Very little. And that little boy was willing to give what he had. This is a lesson. When God wants us to do something, give what you've got. Even if it's just a sandwich. And I can see Jesus somewhere here, breaking the sardines and breaking the bread, giving it to 12 disciples. Man, they were so tired. They were more tired than the tourists coming to this country, carrying those loads of food to the people. And this is the message of Tabkha. Give what you have, and the Lord will multiply it to satisfy the needs of those around you. Read that passage in the Bible. It is so special. It happened twice. Once this side of the lake with the Jews, and then also with the heathen. God not only fed his people, his relatives, his loved ones, he went across the lake to feed the dogs, as the Jews called them. He loves people and he wants to feed people, irrespective of your heritage and your pigmentation. He's a God that transcends the small things that we regard as great. God does not major in minors like we do at times. Read the story again. It's beautiful. This is a very special place. Underneath is an old house dating back to the time of the Second Temple, time of Jesus. Now, according to tradition, the house of Peter was just below the church. You can see some of the ruins here. And the church is over there. This is a 3rd century church built by the Byzantines, but it's built on the original foundation of the church where Jesus healed the demoniac, the man with a paralyzed hand. He did 7 Sabbath miracles in the synagogue, and each miracle has a special message for the special needs of mankind. The 7 Sabbath miracles covers the entire spectrum of mind and body sickness. So whenever you read about Peter, this is where he lived. He was quite a wealthy man. Of course, he had a big business, fishing business here. Johnson & Johnson, I don't know what he called his business. But he did very well. And John and his brother, James, also lived here. They were called the sons of Boanerges, sons of thunder. Jesus took the worst crowd ever, but through example, he changed them. They became disciples, and they were all persecuted. They all died deaths of shame, except John the disciple, the beloved. He died a natural death in his 90s in Ephesus. May you enjoy Capernaum. It's a fantastic little site. This is the 3rd century AD Byzantine church, built on the remains of the original church where Christ preached, the synagogue. Synagogue, the idea of a synagogue was originated, a brainchild from the time of Ezekiel, while they were in exile. The two words mean come together, synago, the Greek. And people had the need of coming together. And you know, Jesus came to church every Sabbath. There were a lot of hypocrites in this church. But it was his custom, says Luke 4:16, to come to church. So if you've got a problem with the Pharisees in your church, follow the example of Jesus and just love them. Just love the Pharisees. I think they're looking for a little bit of attention. Jesus came here. The first time he came here, there was a man with a disturbed spirit. And while Jesus was preaching right here, the man shouted at the back. And everybody got a fright. The children cried. The ladies perspired. The men, I think, were calm. And then Jesus said to him, come here. And he asked the spirit, the evil spirit, to leave the man. This was a marvelous miracle. And after this first miracle, you read it in Mark chapter 1. He went across the road to the house of Peter. And his mother-in-law was dying. They thought she had malaria because of the Hulu situation up here. There were marshes, and some scholars say that she had malaria. And I like the way Jesus treated this old lady. He didn't stand there and say, "Get up." He touched her. Most of his miracles were touching miracles. Nobody touches an old people except a few relatives, and they do not do this with relish because we old people are ugly. But he came, he put his hand around her back, lifted her up with his hand, and healed her. There are so many sick people, people who just need a little touch. The Bible said she put on an apron, if there were aprons in those days. She went to the kitchen and she prepared the Sabbath meal. May God help us to care for the unlovely, the old people, the outcasts. This is what Jesus did. This made him special. He had no degree. He didn't go to Gamaliel to get a degree in theology. But he was the kindest man who ever lived on this earth. And the outcasts were his friends, the harlots and the publicans. They loved to listen to Jesus. And if these stones could speak, they'll repeat his beautiful sermons preached right here. But we've got the Gospels. Read it and enjoy the sermons that Christ preached. Over here it was the sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes, blessed, blessed, blessed. Blessedness comes from blessing others through your unselfish lives. And the multiplication of the bread and the fish is just asking you what you've got. He'll do the multiplication. He only needs your willingness to give what you've got. He'll do the rest. Don't worry about degrees or performances. Give him what you've got. May God bless you as you read the gospel stories. It's the greatest.